السلام عليكم ورحمة الله بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. I'd like to welcome you to this episode where we are looking at how the shayateen, they use families as a tool to come between a couple, and how they use the in-laws and they use the wider family to actually destroy the marriage and to come between the man and his wife. And as we have mentioned, the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in which he told us how Iblis rewards and elevates the shaitan who has managed to cause a man to divorce his wife. And so, as we can imagine, they're going to use any tool, they're going to use anything that they can in order to achieve this end objective of causing separation between a man and his wife. We've looked at how suspicion is used and whisperings are used and how spying is used. But now we want to look at how they may even use your own families against you. Let's look at some certain situations and discuss specifics. Sometimes, believe it or not, the family are the ones who are actually performing the magic. So sometimes the family are the one who actually get a person, put magic on a person, or they get them bewitched. Why? Because, for example, your mother, she is not happy with the choice of spouse and she doesn't like your wife. And so she thinks, you know, this lady, she's not good for my son. I'm going to get him and her broken up. Or perhaps she feels that the woman is going to take her son away from her. So what does she do? She gets magic done on the lady and the magic is broken up. Or alternatively, a man, he may even do magic on his own daughters in order to get back at the mother. So for example, I had a case where a husband and wife, they had five daughters. They had five daughters, and after five daughters, they divorced. They divorced. And so the man, he said to his now ex-wife, he said, "We'll see if your daughters ever get married. We'll see if they are ever going to lead happily married lives." And subhanAllah, by the time they had contacted me, each and every single one of these daughters had been married between two and three times. Every single time they got married, it always led to divorce. They would get married and the marriage would break down. Eventually, subhanAllah, they told me, and this is from the sister, you know, and she told me this, "I found magic," she says, "I found magic with my father. My father was the one who was performing the magic on us. So he made this promise to my mother, you watch, they are never going to get married or they're never going to be happily married. And subhanAllah, we found him and we found that in his Quran, he used to carry a Quran around and people used to think he was very pious and very holy. And when we opened the Quran, we found inside it that he was doing the magic on me and my sisters." This is a father who was willing to disbelieve. He was willing to destroy his own life and destroy the life of his own children because he wanted revenge on their mother. So we see, subhanAllah, sometimes even your own parents, they may do magic on you. It's an amazing affair. Why would somebody disbelieve? At other times, we find that uncles and aunties, they are the ones who are going to do the magic. So perhaps you never married their daughter and they become immensely angry, or they become jealous and they have this hatred and envy, and as a result of that, they do magic on you. In fact, brothers and sisters, I would say that according to my own experience and the research that we do, the most likely person to do magic on you is a person from your own family. It's most likely that somebody from your own family is going to be the one who's doing the magic on you. Less so your own mother and your father. However, as I've mentioned, it is not unheard of, more so the extended family, the uncles and the aunties. I've had very many cases where, for example, an individual will go back home to India or go back home to their motherland of, say, Pakistan or Bangladesh or Sri Lanka, Africa, Egypt, wherever it may be. And they go there and they refuse to marry somebody who, you know, their parents have suggested, or they refuse to marry their first cousin. It's always the case. And as a result of that, they do magic on this individual. Or he's already married and they say out of hatred, you know, you didn't marry my daughter back then, now I'm going to make sure that your marriage is an absolute failure. Now let's look at ways that we can keep and manage these, you know, these situations with regards to our family. The most important thing, in my opinion, is that we have to keep the disagreements that are between a husband and his wife, between husband and wife. Do not be quick to open up your affairs to the close family, even the close family, even your own mother, even your own father. What we have to understand is that as an individual, and this advice goes specifically to the sisters, as an individual who is married and you have left your parents' home and now you're living with somebody else, if every single time that you get upset, or if when you're upset, the first thing that you do is you pick up the phone and you ring home, then I want you to imagine how it looks to your mother. Every time she hears from you, she can hear the upset in your voice. She can hear that you've been crying. She can hear the anger. And then you tell her, he did this, he did that, he doesn't look after me, etc., etc. Now, in the mind of your mother, she's formed a picture of your husband. Regardless of whether 99% of the time he treats you well and you're happy, the 1% of the time that you get angry, you ring home, you ring your sister, you ring your mother, then subhanAllah, they have a file now in their mind. And in that file, the title of that file is, my daughter's husband doesn't look after her. My daughter's husband mistreats her, or whatever it may be. And the more details that you give them, the more this file, it grows and it grows and it grows. Now I want you to imagine, if every time you get upset, you ring your mother, eventually the picture is going to be a very negative one of your spouse. Because you never, when you're happy, you never ring home and say, mommy, I'm really happy with my spouse. You're only going to ring home when you're upset. You're only going to go home in that state when you're very, very upset. So now I want you to imagine the type of advice that you're going to be given. The type of advice that your mother is now going to give to you. She's going to say, you know, this man, he is no good for you. He mistreats you. You're never happy. Because subhanAllah, all the time that you speak about him, it's always in a negative light. It's hardly ever in a positive light. And don't forget that the shayateen, they don't just whisper to you. They'll also whisper to your parents. And so they'll say to your parents, your daughter is better off without this man. You know, she can get a house. The government will provide for a house. The government will give her some money, etc., etc. And so now we're in a situation, we don't need the man. He mistreats her anyway. So my daughter is better off without him. Sisters, this is specifically to you. Don't rush to ring or inform others about your unhappiness or about any injustice. The first thing, try and keep those affairs between you. Because if the person, if there is magic, the first thing that the shayateen are going to try and do is to blow everything out of proportion. And remember, when it's between husband and wife, you kiss and you make up and it's absolutely fine. However, when a third party gets involved, it becomes much more serious and it's not that simple anymore. And you may forget. As a wife, you'll forget. You'll kiss and you'll make up, you'll forget. As a husband, you'll kiss and you'll make up and you'll forget. As for the in-laws, as for that external party, they don't forgive and forget just like that. And so as a result of this, you need to look at the perspective of the person who's giving you advice. For example, if you have a brother or sister and they're not practicing, and for example, you know, you've had a disagreement and you go home and you are taking advice from your brother or sister now. I want to ask you a question. Are they advising you according to the Quran and the Sunnah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ask the people of knowledge if you don't know. Now we have to ask ourselves, the people who we are seeking advice from, what perspective are they looking at? The people who we are seeking advice from and those who are around us, are they knowledgeable about the religion? Are they advising us according to the Quran and according to the Sunnah? Are they people who have ulterior motives? Are they people who we can trust? Are they people who are going to have a negative image because of what we have provided them of information? You need to look at all of these things, my dear brothers and sisters. I have even had cases, for example, where a wife, she has separated from her husband, and the husband has sought reconciliation. The husband has sought mediation. The husband wants to get a third party involved, a neutral third party, and, you know, try and reconcile the marriage. But the sister's family, the woman's family, they have interjected and they have come in between and said, no, all you do is mistreat our daughter. There's no way we're going to allow you to live with her. There's no way she's going to live with you. She's better off without you, etc. Why? The sister partly has only herself to blame, because she has painted such a negative image of that husband that of course the family are going to say, we don't want her to live with this monster. Likewise, when it comes to jinn possession and ruqya and magic, then you have to understand that the jinn, the shayateen, they are not going to allow you to have mediation. So if ever you suspect that there are, you know, problems, external issues, shall we say, related to magic, related to jinn possession, then my, you know, strong recommendation is seek ruqya first. Go and have ruqya performed, or perform ruqya first and foremost before you go into mediation. Because mediation is a secondary step. We need to make sure that this person is not being coerced by magic. We need to make sure that they're not being coerced by jinn. Because if they are, then mediation is going to fail. So we have to make sure we go through the hurdles in the right order. The first hurdle, let's make sure that we are of sound mind, of sound intellect. We're not being coerced, we're not being forced. We are making our own decisions, okay? That's not my sister's making my decision or my mother's making my decision. And likewise for the brothers. We all know that our mothers intend well, but we have to understand that sometimes the truth is not with our mothers. Sometimes our mothers may be at fault. Sometimes our mothers, they make life difficult for our wives. Sometimes your wife may be fine, but your mother is the one who's causing the issues. So subhanAllah, look at all of these different angles. You have to understand that, look, your mother has rights over you and your wife has rights over you. Give everything its right. Give everything its due right. Every person, give them their haqq and do not oppress anybody. Likewise, what the shayateen want and what they will try to nurture and develop is an us versus them mentality. So it's me and my family versus her and her family, and we're going to have these heated debates, these heated discussions. Nothing really constructive is being said. Nothing really constructive is being achieved. However, it's me and my parents who are always going to defend me, and they're never going to accept that I'm in the wrong. And it's her and her parents. And this clash, subhanAllah, all we're doing is we are destroying bridges. We're not building bridges, we're destroying them. Because this hatred and animosity is only going to increase and increase and increase. People's pride, people's arrogance comes in, and they're just like, you know what? Better off, let's leave it alone. Secondly, or the next point that we have to mention, when it comes to ruqya related issues, there may be one or more people in a family who are afflicted. So sometimes it's not just one individual. It may be two or three or four individuals. For example, I dealt with a case recently where all of the women in this family, they were afflicted. Three sisters and all of them are afflicted. I've had cases where two sisters or five sisters even, or an entire family, all of them are afflicted. In this situation, we have to understand that mediation is not going to work. So let's seek ruqya first and foremost. And we can talk about ruqya later on, inshaAllah. Let's seek ruqya first and foremost. Once we've sought that ruqya and we are fine and we are positive that there's nothing wrong, then after that we can go to the next stage of mediation, of sitting down with a person of knowledge. But please stay away from these confrontational type meetings. I've seen it many times and it doesn't achieve anything. All it does, as I've mentioned, is increase the animosity, is increase the upset. You intend good, she intends good. But when you sit down in front of one another, a heated debate ensues and no benefit comes from it whatsoever. So Brothers and sisters, in conclusion to this episode, remember that the shayateen will use any tool that they have available to them. Sometimes, with all the best intentions in the world, the family may be a hindrance to your marriage. Your mother may be a hindrance, your brother or sister may be a hindrance. You have to understand these things. This is why you always remember that you are her husband, she is your wife. Remember this bond which Allah has placed between you. Remember this love which Allah has placed between you. Remember Allah says they are a garment for you and you are a garment for them. Garments, they hide our nakedness. They hide our defects. They cover us. They keep us warm. They keep us safe. This is how the spouse should be, hiding one another's faults. We all know we have faults, but let's hide one another's faults, bringing comfort to one another, beautifying one another's personality. And it shouldn't be, let's rush back to the mother-in-law or let's rush back to the father or the sisters. No, let's keep that between us, especially if there's magic involved. Because if there is magic involved or jinn involved, then they're going to capitalize on this and they're going to whisper to everybody, increasing their animosity, increasing their hatred. What we need in these moments is love. We need rahmah, we need mercy, we need care, and we need to be very gentle because we're treading on eggshells. So in the next episode, inshallah, we're going to look at overcoming these issues, overcoming magic and overcoming these marital problems caused by magic as a family unit, doing it together. How can we work together with these things? And there are some amazing success stories, inshallah, which I hope to share with you. Ultimately, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.